Nothing earth-shattering here in this video, but close to it, very close to it. Today is the 20th, which leaves us, what, 17 days before an election, very consequential election. Most of the companies and businesses in the United States and Europe, etc., have already undertaken all the cost-cutting measures that there is to take. So it seems like we're still floating, still floating, still floating. But there's no more cost-cutting measures they can take without and sustain their business. We face a fiscal cliff when all the tax changes in January go into place January 1st. So we have this enormous trouble staring us right in the face. So we do need a huge boost in our spiritual capacity at this time, because the situation is going to become very unstable soon. So, with that in mind, we are using October to go forward as fast as possible, and I've certainly been doing that. Sometimes you get their insights arise which seem to be difficult to explain, because they're total. There's no exceptions to them, and I had that this morning, that type of insight, and I don't believe I can really, I don't see a way that I can exactly explain it, so you know, intellectually you'll get it, but use this analogy. Let's say there's this octopus, and this octopus doesn't have just 8 tentacles, it has infinite tentacles, and so all these tentacles are at the end of the tentacle. You know, there's a suction cup, each tentacle, billions and billions, let's say 7 billion tentacles, at the end of each tentacle is a suction cup. That suction cup is what we would call I, what we are, our personality, the person, human body, body mind, okay? And so these body minds, human body minds, are interacting with each other, constantly interacting and doing all this stuff, and we call that life. But and we believe, the belief is that there's, that we are somehow doing it, doing all this stuff. But who's really doing it? It's the octopus of belief that is actually manipulating and controlling everything within its kingdom, the kingdom of belief, which is existence, which is where we believe ourselves to be. But ourselves are not the children of belief at all. We are not really here the kingdom of belief. Our identity is not defined at all by the kingdom of belief. Nothing that happens here is consequential in any way or definitional in any way to what we truly are. We're not the body-mind. So it seems like there's all these independent body-minds moving about this world. It is not true. There is only one belief system manipulating itself to make it seem like there's all these separate entities, body-minds with separate will, doing separate things, doing, you know, it's not true. There's this one belief system that arose from spirit wanting to be prime creator, wanting to change reality, and therefore needing to believe it was possible sometime in the future, not now, but in the future. It has to be some way to develop a threat, a way to threaten reality, to force the prime creator to change reality and make spirit prime creator. So out of that arose a belief system, and that belief system has continually projects all these body minds, and it believes, the belief system believes, these body minds are not part of belief, that they're real. They're not. They're still part of belief. A projection is still part of that which is doing the projection. It is not separate. You can project the notion of a separate entity, but it's not separate, because it's not separate from that which is doing the projection. So in belief, belief tries to mimic creation, which creation is extension, ever-expanding extension. Belief mimics it through by projection. So it's projecting like rays of light, all these rays of light, as it were, body minds, going around doing all this stuff, which is really sacrifice, blood sacrifices. What's really taking place in existence is everything is being ceaselessly devoured as a way to build up a threat, try to build up threat to reality. It's doing all of it. There's no such thing as independent people who are doing anything in this world. There is no me, there is no you. independent of belief in this, in existence. But there is an I am presence, that which is what our identity. It is me, it is you, it is everyone, that is untouched by belief. It's not threatened by belief whatsoever. And we are the entity we think of ourselves as body mind is unaware of reality, of what I am presence, of isness, is unaware of that and can never be aware of it. So there can never be any enlightenment for me or you or anybody else, which is really just the tentacles of belief, because belief is fundamentally a rejection of certainty. Okay, the certainty that reality cannot be changed, belief rejects that and denies it. That's its cornerstone, that's its premise that it arises upon, that's built on that premise. So what we are cannot be changed, and is certitude. And therefore belief cannot see it, cannot accept it, denies it. So what we believe ourselves to be is really a denial of what we really are. That is a fact. And this personality we take ourselves to be, it's not us at all. It's nothing to do with what we really are. And it's not some separate body, mind, or anything. It is simply one tentacle of belief that is completely being manipulated by belief, 100%. Now, what belief does is it's trying to figure out what the defenses of reality are, so it can destroy those defenses, get past those defenses, breach the defenses, and threaten reality. So what it does, it keeps setting us up, giving us stuff to find out how we would defend it, keeping it. And then seeing the defenses, the ways that we use to keep it, then it finds out ways to take it away from us. So belief can give gifts. I'm going to try and go win a car today. They're giving away a free Mercedes at a place. So I want to see if the key will start the car. Now, let's say it starts the car and I won the car. Well, the fact is, I'll have to defend that car. I'll have to tax on it, licensing on it, registration on it. Then there'll be insurance on it. And all those will add up, you know, to a lot of money, plus, and you know, probably premium gasoline, and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then you have to have, you know, alarm systems. You don't want to get stolen. You don't want it to get in an accident. You don't want to, you know, you have to protect it, somehow have to cover it in the driveway to keep it from getting dirty. You have to wash the car, clean, you know. You have to protect it. Everything in this world you get, you have to protect it. Everything. You have to protect your body constantly from dying. So what belief gives you is vulnerability. That's what it gives you, vulnerability. And then goes about seeing how you go about protecting it, because belief knows that you have some sort of intelligence it does not have. There's something that arises, you know, that in our defense of it, so to speak, our desire to have it. Belief believes that the defenses are the defenses of God. Somehow we're getting intelligence from God on how to defend this stuff. In other words, if you get a new car, you think, oh, God gave me this car. Now God will tell me how to protect this car and keep it, you know, keep from losing it. And then belief says, okay, let's study this. Let's collect all this data, study it, and we'll find out how can we then manage to separate them from what they have. But it's only belief. It's actually belief that is creating these defenses. That is not creating, but is believing up these defenses. It doesn't seem to be aware of this, but it's one hand doesn't know what the other one's doing. So we get stuff, and then the belief tells us how to defend against it. You know, so belief is defend against the attack of belief. Part of belief is getting and defending. Part of belief analyzing and attacking, finding a way to get past that defense systems. And then it culls all this data, constantly calling data to figure out a way to threaten reality. So you got to be careful about getting gifts. Someone gives you something, gives you a house, gives you this, this. Here you go. Here's a gift. You know, it could very well be that you are simply again being used to see how is this defended? How is this going to be defended? What steps do you take to prevent it yourself from losing it? What steps are you taking? You see, and that's all part of this belief system. Now, there is the time-honored remedy for this. You hear about it in spiritual traditions, surrender. Let go of the world, drop the world, etc. What it means is let go of anything and everything that is vulnerable, that needs protection, that needs defense. Let it all go and see what remains. What remains is that which doesn't need any defense. And then that is what you are. You have that, and nothing can take it away from you. It doesn't need to be defended. Imagine, just consider how wonderful that would be. The testimony of the ages is from those who have done this, is that they're left in this state of bliss and peacefulness and a very, very feelings that are transcendent of anything that belief can give us. Because they know that what they are, what their identity, which is what they really are, doesn't need any defense, and they have it, can never be taken from them. And yet here we are engrossed in this belief system, this dance of Maya, dance of belief, getting all this stuff we think is an identity that we think we believe we are, and this identity we believe we are getting things we believe will protect it, and then we dreaming up belief dreams up defenses to hold on to this stuff and prevent someone else from taking it away, or tragedy, you know, all sorts of stuff that end up dispossessing the identity we believe we are of whatever it has. Like grains slipping through, you know, our hands, it just slips through the cracks and we end up losing it, desperately fighting not to. We don't need to worry about that because we have something that is totally certain, totally peaceful, totally blissful, totally delightful, totally non-threatened, can never be taken away from us, needs no defense whatsoever. So imagine the relief that will come to us when we are willing to let everything that needs any defense at all, we unbind it from ourselves. We let go. Say, I'm not going to make any effort to hold on to anything. No effort to hold on to anything. That is called the spiritual surrender, which results in awakening to realization of what we really are. It's called realization, meaning realization of our true identity. And some have done this. Some have done this. And then they get used to this abiding in what they truly are. They get used to it. They spend the rest of their days simply getting comfortable with it, getting familiar with it. And we can do that too. Anyone can do it. Anyone can do it. And it's a super great time to do that because there's going to be an enormous push in the world to dispossess everyone of what they have. That's the purpose of the world. Everything, the universe, belief system, what we call the universe, gives only for the purpose that then it can then take away and assess the defenses that arise to try and prevent this takeaway from happening. That's it. So of course, there will come a time when you build up, everyone has a lot of stuff, and then there's a period of time when it all gets taken away. Look throughout history. That's all that's happened throughout history. You have civilizations arise, and civilizations fall, and they're buried in the sands. You have situations where there's a wealthy nation, and the wealthy nation ends up crumbling into poverty. People get stuff, gets taken away on massive scales, you know, the dispossession, like for instance in the Soviet Union, the middle class, the landowners, the business owners, all those people who represent the middle and upper middle class, what we call it, they got everything taken away from just like that, just by dispossessed by decree and by police action and sent to the gulags. If they were lucky, they got sent to the gulags. Lost everything. You see, and it's happened over and over and over and over throughout history, and you can see it coming again, that there's going to be this time of people losing the things that they believe that are so important to them. Stuff they don't want to lose. And desperate attempts will be made to try and hold on to that. All this is just data being culled by belief. Belief will just study the whole situation, record it all, study it all, and try to analyze, you know, what information it got out of this scenario to how it can be applied to get past the defenses of reality. But the truth is that reality doesn't have any defenses, which is why belief's having such a hard time. Belief can't figure out what the defenses are. So it keeps trying to generate this vulnerability. It keeps believing in this dance of vulnerability to see, find out what's defensiveness all about. It's trying to imagine what defensiveness of reality could be like and then attack that defensiveness. The truth is there is no defensiveness. The reason why belief has not found out how to attack reality, what the defenses of reality are, is because reality has no defenses, doesn't need them. Nothing real can be threatened at all. So belief is just wasting its time and all this rigmarole that it goes through, all this constant devouring of itself and giving to take away, giving to take away, giving to take away, is simply wasting its time because reality has no defenses. But it can't believe that. It cannot believe that. Belief can't believe truth. Cannot. So it continues to do this. And you can't reason with belief at all. You cannot. It's incapable of reasoning from truth. It's impossible. It has logic from its own premise. Cannot reason from truth at all. So it's total waste of time to attempt that with belief. What we're doing is we say we have a remedy. And from a practical standpoint, right now, we really can practice letting go of everything. Don't try to hold on to anything. Somehow, that's called a surrender or unbinding of the world. Dropping, setting the world down means to don't try to hold on to anything at all. Not even any thoughts about the world. Not any actions, not any things, not any situations, not any relationships, not any people, not any money. Nothing at all. Not thoughts, not feelings, not emotions, not memories. Nothing. Let go of everything. An attitude of letting it all go. And what will remain, and everything seems to drop away, is what we truly are. That needs no defense and needs no holding on to. You know, it is what we, what is. It is what is. It is what we are. Don't have to hold on to it. And then at that point, it's possible to flow in the world with all sorts of stuff coming into your life, whatever you need, without any attachment whatsoever. Because you know it has nothing to do with what you are. It'll come and it'll go, it'll come and it'll go. Everything in the universe comes and goes, comes and goes, comes and goes. But what you are remains the same. What we are remains the same. It doesn't come or go at all. And it doesn't require any defense or any effort to hold on to it. But we won't know that until we let go, are willing to let go of everything. Stop holding on to anything. And then we will find out that there is something that doesn't need to be held on to. But we're afraid to do it because we're not sure of that. That's where the ambassadors of truth, of reality, of certainty, of our true identity help us by reassuring us that, yeah, there is that central core I am presence of isness that needs no defense and we don't need to hold on to it at all. That is there in all of us. So we need to loosen our attachment to the world. That's another way. So you don't be attached, loosen our attachment. But it's more of a dropping away. I wonder if Eckhart Tolle, when he talks about the pain body, one night just dropped away from him entirely. I wonder if that's what he is getting at. It could be. There are those throughout history that have had situations they've explained it maybe in different ways. What it really is simply, again, this decision to not make any effort to hold on to anything at all. Even thoughts, even insights, nothing. Just let it all go. And when you get to that point, when you can do that, then inevitably there will be this realization of what remains, which is what I am, presence of isness remains. And then you will simply abide in that. And you won't be engaged in believing that you have to hold on to anything to be what you are. See, belief tricks itself. And the remember, this identity, this personality, it isn't under our control at all. It's under the control of belief entirely. So belief has our personality struggling to maintain its identity. It believes it's an identity and needs to maintain its life, its identity, and it needs all to protect itself because it's a body. The body's so vulnerable. That's just all the play of belief. It has nothing to do with what we really are. And so those who have realized their true identity, they lose all fear of death entirely, all fear of loss. Nothing affects them. The dance of belief doesn't affect them anymore. They just smile and laugh, and it's like a shadow play. It's nothing. They're not concerned about it at all anymore. That is a real goal, can really be reached by us. Absolutely can. It's better to do it this way than to have belief strip this believed in identity of everything, including, you know, it's the life of the body, as a guinea pig test to see, you know, how the defenses work and how successful the attack works on it. It's better for us to be the ones who are in control, and so let's voluntarily ahead of time not hold on to anything at all. That's the real spiritual approach, and it's a great time to do that. Otherwise, we're going to have everything, you know, pried from our fingers, as it were, and it's going to be traumatic. Every step of the way will be traumatic. We're just headed into trauma. That is, the future is trauma. That is what the future is in this, on this planet. It is trauma. And you will find, you know, everything slipping through your fingers. And it's just one devastation, one blow after the other, ceaseless blows coming up. And yet, we have the know-how to bypass that by voluntarily deciding to let go of everything, to not have any effort to hold on to anything at all. And that's when we find what we truly are doesn't need any effort, doesn't need to be held on. It's always included in reality. Reality is perfectly, totally, unconditionally inclusive. So everything that reality, that the expansion of what is, of isness, everything is perpetually, endlessly, eternally included in that expansion of what is. And that means what is true, what our true identity is, perfectly included, always will be. And we'll get richer and richer and greater and greater abundance forever. That is what we already have that. It's just that belief cannot believe it. So as long as we desire to be prime creator, we will believe in belief. We will believe that belief is consequential. We will accept a belief system. We will accept it and have this desire that it be true, except it's not true. See, we have a desire that belief is true. Belief saying that reality is not permanent. It's not permanent. It could be changed. We have a desire to change reality because we want to be prime creator. So this desire to change reality is belief. So as long as we have this desire to change reality, we will put our faith in belief. We will desire that belief be true. We will desire that belief be true. And we will have this pretend that it is true. And therefore, we will pretend, this pretense will not be aware of what we are, of reality. Will not be aware of it. Because we desire to not be aware of it. That's our experiencing, our attempt to experience ourselves as prime creator includes this desire, this belief that to be unaware of what we truly are. It's not as tricky as we may consider. It's not. It's the desire gives rise to this belief system, and we want it to be true. We desire it to be true, therefore we assume, pretend that it is true. And we believe, therefore we assume, we desire that this make-believe identity is our real identity. And we desire that this make-believe identity is vulnerable and does need to cling to stuff and hold on to stuff, you know, and fight to keep it from being taken away. We desire that all this be true, but it's not. It's just the play of belief. It's not, no truth to it whatsoever. Now, when you meet a ambassador of certitude, whether internally or externally, they have no desire that belief be true. And you feel this, and your own desire that belief be true subsides. And when it subsides, you feel, I feel like not trying to hold on to anything, letting everything go. Just let everything go. I don't see it as necessary. And then realization can actually take place. It is really possible. It's absolute. Sometimes we have a willingness to not hold on to anything, and we get a glimpse of our true identity, a brief realization, and then we, you know, start desiring that belief be true again, because we're not quite sure what happened. But if we are, the more aware and clear we are of what it is that will happen in the situation, then when we are willing to not have belief be true, not desire that belief be true, then we don't need to hold on to anything. Let's let everything go. Just no attitude of holding on. No holding on. We realize what we really are. We can then abide in that. Just stay with it. Just stay with it. And it doesn't mean we won't have anything, because belief will absolutely actually try to give us all sorts of stuff at that point. Belief will say, oh my gosh, I got to find out, you know, let me give this one everything so I can find out how they defend against losing it. So they'll probably try to give you all the money and gifts and whatever they can shower upon you. Belief will try to give that to you. And then whatever is useful, you can use, and you can just, if it's not, you just let it go. But there's no attachment to it, no holding on to it, that kind of thing. So these are the great opportunities that we have here. The big boost, we can really come across perfect certainty. And we really have now this tool of letting go, not holding on, just deciding to not hold on to anything. And we can do that. That is something that can be done. Probably the most effective exercise is this more and more willingness to not hold on to anything. Floating free of any attachment, of any need to grasp or hold on to anything. Get into that mood, that attitude. That's what, you know, teachers help with. And the more we can get into that attitude, the more closer we get to really letting go and not holding on to anything, which will result in realization of the self, of our true identity, which will then really make us invulnerable to anything that happens in the world, because what we really are is not vulnerable at all. And this would be like, the world is just like, again, just like a dream, play of imagination. It's not consequential at all. So we have this attitude of bliss, of peace, of unconcern. And how does that help others? By helping reassure them that they can let go too. See? So it builds up a beautiful domino effect coming up. And we can do it. Absolutely, we can do this. And it's something that we will do. It's essential that we do it, because I've already been through the trauma of getting a lot of stuff and having it taken away. I've been through it. It's horrible. It's really horrible. It's torture. It is really torture. It seems like every day you die. Okay, so that's it for this video. Someone is calling me. Very great.